All right, motherfuckers. No, you guys are motherfuckers. I love you. I love everybody out there. 97 subscribers I'm at right now. Unless this went down or up. I don't know. That's fucking sick. You know, I had a prediction that by the end of the year, I'd be at 100 subscribers. And shit, I'm fucking 3 away. Like, it's fucking awesome. I'm so happy. I couldn't be happier, actually. Once again, it's very hard to separate myself from wanting those numbers to go up. I try my best. I try not to be, you know, I'm not trying to be all new agey and say I don't attach myself to that. And it's not about that, because it's about me being able to speak this shit out and enjoy it and all that. But I mean, you know, my podcast is doing fucking great. I'm getting like $50 a fucking month. I'm American, so Canadian, that's like almost 70. And YouTube is going up, you know, and you know, the views haven't really changed. I'm just getting more subscribers, so I don't care why. I think it's awesome. So anyways, so I just finished one video, and this was a video that's been going on for a week, and I've been trying to figure out what to say in it. And then when I realized I was already at like an hour, it's like, fuck man, if I start actually talking about Yalvadoff and the disciples and how the Gnostic view is Yalvadoff is evil and Lucifer or the snake and or other things are the good guy, and even there's a lot of speculation that Lucifer is Jesus and Jesus is the light bringer because Jesus says he is the morning star, and I know that's interpreted as Jesus is kicking the devil out of the spotlight and he's becoming the morning star, he's becoming the sun, the brightest star in the sky. But there's so many different ways to interpret this shit, and I'm not going to tell anybody who's right or wrong. I'm not even going to tell you my opinion. I'm going to tell you what I know is to be true, so I guess I'm going to give you my opinion. But I guess what I'm trying to say is I'm going to, I don't know, let me play something for you right now, okay, just to get you intrigued. Now, I really like this guy. I really like this guy's channel. And I'm not necessarily an someone who studies empiricism. Well, actually, I've studied a little bit about what their beliefs are, just to have a base knowledge of it. And I think it's very interesting, and I think there's a lot of things I agree with this guy named Morg that I'm going to play for you. Like seriously, there's more that I agree with him than disagree. Obviously, there is a bunch of things that I also disagree with him on as well, but, man, like, me and my wife, we disagree all the time, and I married her. So, like, why can't I disagree with this man and still play his content and still discuss him? Now, some people might think he's satanic or Luciferian, but he is Iperian. He's an Iperianism. Iperianist? I don't even know how to say that, but you'll hear him talk about this. He at least always says Iperianism at least probably seven times per video, which is fine. He's promoting what he believes in, what he thinks is the way. And I don't think he's necessarily pushing it on people, but he's being a spokesperson, and he's not necessarily trying to, I don't think he's trying to, how do you say it? Trying to hook people into his, you know, force people into his belief systems, trying to go around, oh my god, I can't think of the word, trying to, not adopt people, but trying to convert people. He's not going around trying to convert people. He's putting the message out there, and you find his channel. Like, I found it by mistake. So when I wanted to learn a little bit more about Yalvadoff, because I heard that in my last video when I was making it, which I think I may have known, but I don't know. I don't remember knowing that stuff. That Samael, my favorite character, my favorite deity, the devil also, Lucifer also, Satan also, and all the variations thereof. But then when I heard that Samael is essentially one of the names for Yalvadoff, I was like, huh, that's fucked up. But then at the same time, Samael is also a name for the devil. And it's like, well, the Gnostic view of Yalvadoff is that Yalvadoff is an evil entity and the devil is potentially good. So how can the devil be Samael and then Yalvadoff be Samael? And it's like, well, there's one way, the all. The all is both the good and the bad and everything. Ah, fuck. Drop my smoke. Is everything in between. The good, the bad, the ugly, the pretty, the fucking beautiful, the what makes sense, what doesn't make sense, the truth, the lies, it's everything. It's all. It's all. We are all the all, and the all is all us. So, every asshole you see on the road that you don't agree with, every person on YouTube who's a fucking prick to you, every hater, every beautiful person who's trying to help, everybody who's selfless, every saint, every fucking deity, every god, everything is all the all. We are all the all our thoughts, all our ideas are all part of the all. And, you know, I will eventually make a video about, because he talks about magic and how, people, I think someone left a comment one time on his channel saying how you can think things into existence and manifest stuff and stuff to that effect, let's say. And he said that we're all part of the all and we're all making this thing collectively. So he made the point that you can't necessarily change stuff with just thoughts in your life. I don't know if that's accurate completely. I don't know if he's had videos against that, so I'm not going to try to put words in his mouth. But that was what I gathered he said about that specific topic. And I was like, okay, I know a bunch of ways I can make his argument, the same argument he just made, make sense for how you can manifest. And maybe I'll do that here, the first thing I'll talk about, and then I'll get into the rest. First, I need to find the cigarette and see if it's still fucking lit under my seat. So, I'll run the fucking song, and then I'll run his pitch, and then we'll keep going. Don't be wasting none of my time. This world's like a cage, and I don't think it's fair. Fucking thankfully it went out when I grabbed it. It wasn't still lit, so that was pretty fucking cool. Okay, I got one more stop before I have to go home, get Austin, and bring him to Walmart and grab whatever the fuck he wants to buy, and then you can grab mom's bacon and eggs if you want. So I don't want to touch that poor dead piggy. No, seriously, if you eat meat, I'm okay with that. I don't give a shit. Do I eat meat? Talk about that in a future video. I want to know, I'll look at my old videos, but things have changed, not gonna lie. But anyways, we won't get into that at the moment. So, where the fuck was I? Oh, Yabadoff and all that shit and this guy. Oh yeah, okay, so, he's gonna, like he said in the one video that we're all part of the all. And Hyperionism, we're all of us make up the all, the collective. We're all collectively making this humanity, this subjective, I'm trying to think of how you put it. I'm trying my hardest to put words in his mouth, because I really do like this guy, so I'm not trying to diss him at all. I'm just going to try to see how I can wiggle around his white buffalo, wiggle around his version of how magic doesn't necessarily work. You can't make stuff come into your reality. But he says we're all the all, and all of us are projecting this reality into existence. And we can't do it ourselves because there's other people's minds involved. You have to affect everybody's mind simultaneously for magic to work. While there's truth in what he just said there, and this is how you would have to change the world as a whole. Okay. This is how you can change the world as a whole. But I don't believe that that's entirely correct, because my family, my kids, my wife, okay, they're all part of my reality. So the things I have the most success with when I do magic, when I perform any kind of rituals or sigils or just candle magic, whatever it is, the best success I ever have, if I'm trying to do something, change yourself, okay? Trying to change others, trying to change the world as a whole, using magic to do it, very tough. And the reason is what he just said. It's possible, but very tough. To change your own self, your own reality is very easy because you're in charge of your fucking life and your reality. You can change what, in your point of view and what you believe in and all that shit. It's very easy for you to change that. Now, the more minds that believe that you are a certain way or a certain something, well then that's what makes it harder. So, for example, if a lot of people know I'm addicted to drugs and I'm trying to use magic to change them, I'm going to have to really do hard work to get that. But people's minds are also going to play a part in that. So without changing their view of me and thinking I'm trying, thinking it's possible, whatever, I'm going to have a hard time. Not impossible, but I'm going to have a hard time. Whereas if there's something I have a secret of, I have a secret sex addiction, let's say. Nobody knows about it. Nobody fucking knows about it. No one's the wiser of it. And I want to change that. So the only mind that knows that is mine. Now everybody's subconscious is linked. But the only mind that knows that is me. So I can change that very easily. Well, that's kind of how what I'm talking about. So there's a lot of personal things in your life that you can bring in. So let's say you want something, whether it's money, whether it's love, whatever the case is. But you don't have that thing yet. So in everybody's mind, you don't have that thing. It doesn't mean it's not possible for you to not get it by doing a symbolic ritual, anything from sigils to straight up ritual to candle magic, like what I perform, to the visualizations, whatever method you want to use. And everybody has methods that work better for them. Like, I'm better probably with candle magic and sigils, somebody else might be better with the visualizations and hypnosis and shit like that. Well, doing recordings and shit, which is pretty powerful, that works pretty good for me too. But nonetheless, everybody's gonna have a better means, one better way than another to do magic. So the point I'm trying to get at is because of what he said is fucking true, you can affect your microcosm, okay? You can affect your reality. But the more minds that are involved in the thing that you're trying to change, the harder it's going to be, but it's not possible. Now, a way around that, let's say your family, your direct family, family in your house is the ones that are directly involved in knowing whatever it is that you're trying to change, okay? They know whatever, they believe that you're never going to change this part of you, but you're able to change it. You want to change it. Well, you can put sigils up in the entire house, okay? That say, a sigil is a symbol that used to be a statement. So, I am so grateful that I am free from using drugs. That's your statement. And you turn that into a symbol. You put that symbol all over your home where people are going to walk by it every day and not pay any attention to it, but their subconscious still picks it up. It picks up everything. Okay? Suppressed memories that you don't even remember, they're in there. Okay? That literally picks up everything. And I don't know if that would be the subconscious, if that would be the unconscious. I know it's part of the older parts of the brain that were around before we were even evolved, before we had a neocortex, okay? But nonetheless. So, where's it going with that? Oh yeah. Anyways, so everybody's mind who has a theory of who you are and how you're never gonna change, you start getting symbols in their subconscious that they're not even seeing that you are changing, and boom, you're gonna see that magic. You're gonna see that possibility manifest. I'm telling you, it fucking works. I've done it. Now, most of the time, the person you've got to convince more than anybody is yourself. And that's where, and I don't know, I'm not saying affirmations as in this new age, or the way you just say something day to day, it's going to happen to you, how it works, I'm talking about my friends. But that is part of the equation. And you can do that, you can add that to it, but you need to do your affirmations before bed, if you can. And honestly, you're going to fall asleep doing them. So it's better to have it on a recorder that you listen to while you're in that fucking, going into that, was it beta? Yeah, or delta state, maybe? As you're going into that, then you're going right into the subconscious mind. They fall asleep and playing over and over and over in your head, and it's getting lodged in there, I'm telling you. The way to convince yourself. But everybody's reality is affected. But magic, like I said, has always been the shortcut to manifestation. And it's the way us in magic, we're connecting to our subconscious mind, connecting to the collective unconscious. So we can affect all, because we have that direct connection to the thing that connects us all together. And by doing magic, we can get other minds involved to give us results. We can affect all the people that want a bunch of money. Well, someone's going to leave that money in a bag on the fucking ground. You're going to affect everybody's mind who's involved in that. The person who leaves it there, the person who gave it to that person, the people that walked by and didn't even notice it, you know, all those people and all the circumstances that led you to get to that bag of money that day, your boss had to lift off early, your wife called you home, you had to go to the kids, all these things, your kids get sick, whatever it is, all those things had to happen, so you affect all those minds and then bam, that happens. So this is just a few ways I would take his argument, and I would tell him this is how I believe magic actually is real, using the same argument. So that's all I would say to that. I don't know where the good place is for me to put you. So there it is. I like to hold it, and then move it around, we get some static. Okay. Before I go any further, before I get to the part where I play Buddy, I've been talking about Mork, once again, I have nothing against the guy. I think what he's saying and doing is good. I hope no one holds it against him. And I should let you guys explore him for yourself. Watch his videos where he says it, but he's a binary, let's call him non-binary person, I think he is, gender is. So I kept saying guy, but I hope that doesn't offend him as well. And I don't mean any harm by that, so get that out of the way. But before I get to him, or Morg, rather, I use him by his name, out of respect, I just want to talk about what I just talked about. So, the whole magic thing about changing your reality. Now, depending on the severity of the thing you're changing, I think there's something you need to know. So, I'm going to play a very small clip, less than 5 minutes, from Peterson, explaining the science and the neurology and how the brain operates behind, by, how would you classify that? Certain routines that you do that give you certain small dopamine hits, anything small from taking a sip of coffee. And he doesn't say it in this because he's teaching a class in this one, but I've heard him in different, whether it's the Bible lectures or different podcast interviews he's on or any different content he's had where he's talked about the urges and things in your body and addictions, people that have big addictions like cocaine and drug addictions, how it's almost like a monster, an entity that they've created. And he doesn't explain it like this in this, but he calls it a thing. This thing makes them, anyways, you'll see after I play it, and then I'll break it down a bit, but I just want to show this first so I can add some complexity layers to what I just said about using magic to change things about your life. Now, knowing what I'm about to put on here and say doesn't change the fact that you still can use magic to do this, but it complicates things if you have something like a chemical dependency and through different repetition and habitual continuously doing the same habit over and over and over again, and every time you achieve the goal of getting drugs or getting alcohol or getting money to get those things, it reinforces the dopamine hit while you're doing that process. And like I said before, I was there. I was in complete withdrawal, can't get off the couch. The minute I knew I was going to go pick up a pill, a painkiller, a heroin, substance almost, not heroin per se, but it all breaks down as morphine in your body, which is basically an opiate. The minute I got the call saying, hey, you can come pick it up, whether I had money or the guy was going to front me something, I stopped being dope sick and I could walk across my town, okay, in the cold, free from pain. Like, I'd have some pain, but I'd be able to put it on the side, and he'll explain why, these urges control you. They put everything else aside for the moment and get you to where you got to go to accomplish that task. So, I just wanted to make this known so people, maybe if people don't know this, it might be easier for them to use magic to get to these ends. But if they don't receive these ends, if they don't receive any results, I hope this is still hearing me. If they don't receive results, I don't want them to throw the baby out with the bathwater. I just want them to realize it's a little more complicated and there's other things that you may have to do to get results if you're dealing with something as strong as a chemical dependency, drugs or alcohol. Now, if it's not that strong, then no worries. But anyways, I'm going to play this clip right here, and then I'm still going to get to Morg and Yalvadov and Jesus, what he says to Judas. And I really like this story, by the way. I really like the thought of Judas being that evil entity of the Gnostics, the creator god. I really like the idea that he might be that at the same time as Jesus was alive, and that's why he betrayed him. I think that's a cool concept. I think it's a really nice twist to that story. I don't think any of this is real, but I think it's a really cool twist to the story. That's what we're going to get to. But first, I want to play this part, and we're going to dissect it a little bit just so I can, you gotta get magic in here, right? I gotta throw some magic in here for some people, because if people don't always like the psychology stuff, and they look to my channel, because every once in a while I give out very slight information about magics that I do, that I've done. Well, I gotta throw some in there so that there's some content for everybody. So, also, before I get to Morgue, maybe I'll just go over some of the small magics I've done in the house, including, like, things that have happened to my smallest daughter, my youngest daughter. She's been saying stuff like, I talked to monsters at night, and shit like that. You know, I'm going to break that down a little bit and tell you what I've done, and so on and so forth, just to get a little bit of magic in here, and then we'll keep moving on to Bible stories and entities and all that other shit. So
here, and so far as this is a cup, because it could be tinder for lighting a fire, for example, or something to stomp on to make a noise, insofar as it's a cup, then understanding it means pattern mapping it onto exactly this. And if I do that successfully, then I get a little reward, a little hint, a little kick of dopamine. And that dopamine makes me feel a little bit better. But it also bathes the neural tissue that I use to make that perceptual, to structure that perception, and also to undertake that act. And it makes it just a little bit more likely that I'll see it that way and act that way in its presence again. And that's how you learn, right? You lay out a perceptual scheme. It's got a goal. If the perceptual scheme and its associated action patterns make the goal manifest itself, then you get a little burst of positive emotion, click. Then that makes it, those little the neural circuits that instantiated that thrive a little bit and get a little bit more predominant. And that's also why you got to watch yourself if you're taking psychomotor stimulants like cocaine or alcohol, even for that matter, because they produce hyper-learning. And so, you know, I'll glance at that and maybe it'll trigger off a bit of thirst. But if I was a cocaine addict and that was cocaine paraphernalia and I glanced at it, it was like, whap, that thing that I've built in my head out of repeated, you know, massive hits of dopamine is going to grab my perceptual structures and my actions and bring me, that'll be that craving, which is an impulse to move forward towards it. You'll feel that instantiated in your body. That's the craving. It's very, very difficult to get rid of that. Even if you're a cocaine abuser and you've gone to a treatment center for several weeks and got over the worst of the at least initial parts of the relearning not to abuse, the second you go back into your natural environment and take a look at the cues, bang, that thing will be right back there directing your action. And what happens is when one of those perceptual systems comes up, you can see this when you're hungry, it suppresses all the other potential perceptual systems. You can see this when you're angry too, right? You get angry and you're angry with your partner and all you can think of is all the stupid things they've done for the last 10 years. You don't even remember that you like them. It's like you can remind them, I know you're mad, but remember you like me. Well, not right now. You know, so it shows you how those micro personalities can dominate and suppress. That's what happens. Because if they didn't suppress the other micro personalities, they wouldn't be able to run themselves to conclusion. And then you'd never get what you want. Okay, so anyways.
All right. Okay, so a lot of important shit there. So, once again, I started this, I put this on here as the basis to complicate my own theory on how you can manifest reality, since I went off of something that I didn't play for you, by the way. And once again, I don't want to put words in Morgue's mouth. He could be someone who thinks you can manifest reality. As far as I know, as far as what I've seen so far from what I've watched, I don't think he believes in that. Now, he said, told someone to watch a lucid dreaming video that he made, and I don't know why, but if you can lucid dream, if you can seriously start doing things in your dreams, you can actually, that's powerful magic, really powerful magic, because it's like you're right in your subconscious mind affecting it. So if you can take control of your, and I haven't been able to do this yet, so I won't lie, I can get lucid in my dreams. I can, not even consistently, not even all the time, but all of a sudden it's like, okay, I know this is a dream. And when I start to try to take control of it, I tend to wake up. When I try to switch too much of like where it's going, let's say the dream's going in one direction, but I'm like, no, I want to go to my altar and do something, or I want to go see if I can go ask my boss for a raise and, you know, figure whatever I want to try to do. I'm changing the whole background of my dream. I tend to wake up, so I don't tend to be able to manifest in that way yet. But I am still practicing. I'm still trying to, once I know I'm in the dream, and I think I know where the dream is going, I try to find a way to get to where the dream is going to go and use that to my benefit in some way, shape, or form. But still, nonetheless, it still normally ends up in being, I wake up whenever I'm trying to switch it too much. But anyways, back to what Peterson just said. Now, so I played this once again because I wanted to say if anybody's trying to get rid of an addiction or a bad habit that they have, that it might be more complicated and you may not be able to do it as easily as just making a sigil saying, I'm so grateful that I am no longer addicted to cocaine. And that's just going to get rid of it. It might help suppress you wanting to use. It might help some other things. Like that, right? Say you're just at home, you got rid of all your paraphernalia, you got rid of all your numbers, and you try not to go out as much so you don't run into people, you don't drink, and you know, and you do these sigils. You're going to have a good chance. You'll have a good chance if you can actually set it and forget it and just have faith that it's going to work. You got a chance. The problem is whenever one of these triggers come up, like you heard Peterson said, that thing, okay, because he says every time he goes to get that cup of coffee, and then he takes that sip and everything works out good, and then he gets that little hit of dopamine, like everything worked out good, and on top of that, the caffeine is a chemical, it is a drug after all, so you get a little hit of dopamine, okay, but with something like alcohol and drugs, it's like a double. I made videos about this in the past. It's like a double dopamine hit every single fucking time, because not only are you getting the dopamine connection, especially with opiates, that's connecting that part of the brain. It literally connects that part of the brain where it's like the goal system of your brain. When you're achieving a goal, you're connecting the part of your brain where the dopamine hits, okay? The medicine I used to take, I was taking Suboxone, that was its job. It connected that for me, but without the high reward system. So it was always connected for me, so it felt like as soon as I took it, I felt like, okay, I'm okay. But before, and, you know, anyways, it doesn't matter. But I know this might be, because I'm trying to lay out an argument for why Morg is incorrect about why we can't manifest reality. And then I said what I had to say, like, well, we are all the all. And if you connect to that part of your mind, the subconscious mind, then you can start connecting and changing your microcosm. Okay, your reality, not the macro, but the micro, yours, because you got reality as a whole, we're all part of it, we're all creating this illusion, this reality, collectively, together, okay, and that's why things like TV, media, newspapers help, because it tells you how the world is in other places, so then you make this picture in your mind of how these places are, and everybody's picture in their mind has commonalities, some of them are differ, but for the most part, that big picture that's in everybody's mind helps create what's going on. So that's why it's easy to control us with media. It's always been easy to control us, and it'll always be a tool to control us. Now they start losing their grasp because people stop watching the news, TV, and people start getting their power back, and then all of a sudden COVID hit. Everybody's watching the news to see how many people are dying, seeing what's going on with COVID, and now they got their power back once again to try to take our minds, and it's like, bad idea. But anyways, I'm not even going to touch that right now. But, sorry about that. As much as this might be damaging to my argument that you can manifest what you want, but if you have a chemical dependency, it's a little harder. And I still stand by that. That's what I'm going to get into more than anything. But at first, I just want to lay out the fact that what he said is proof of us being able to manifest our reality. And you can say, well, how's that proof? It's like, well, because if you don't have a chemical or alcohol dependency, okay, if you don't have anything like that, when you start on an endeavor, whether it's like, okay, I never done siding, eavesdrop, masonry, bricklaying, none of that before, when you get into that field, you told your body, your brain, that you want to learn this. You want to learn this fucking field. Well, it's going to change, adapt, plasticity, neuroplasticity. It's called that because it can be molded like plastic. And you are going to be, all the information you ever had that might pertain to what your field is going to come blasting at you, okay? And if you enjoy it, and if you start doing good, then it's going to keep directing you forward, okay? What he said in this, the important parts he said in this thing, Peterson said in this thing, was that, let's just take habits on a whole, okay? Because habits can be good or bad. Now, what we're doing in magic, so Ritual magic is the shortcut to be able to manifest. The old way is through habitual habits. That's why affirmations can work if done properly and not in the weird new agey, like just say what you want a few times and you'll get it. Like, no, that's not true. You have to do it so often that it becomes a fucking habit. And then the only time the affirmation starts working is when you get to the point where you're saying your affirmations without even knowing you're saying them. Like, okay, you get into the routine every night before bed, you start saying your affirmations or listening to something, okay? That becomes a routine. You try and do that for 28 days. It's like, oh, I gotta do this again, I gotta do this again, I gotta do this again. When you get to the point where you're just laying down, putting them on, or you fall asleep and you just start saying them and you're having this dream about you saying your affirmations, that means you just started getting into the subconscious mind. That means you're close because you just created the habit of doing your affirmations. So that means you're fucking close. Your best bet's not to focus on that, dwell on that. Just keep doing it because now you're really fucking close. But you have to break into there. So through habitual actions, you can create. Or other than that opinion, I think I believe on with him on like 85% of the things. I agree with him on 85% of the things that he says. Once again, I'm not saying I think Yelbanov is the evil god of the Bible and Lucifer is technically the real god. I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying I agree with his point of view on that. I'm saying the way he... To me, that's irrelevant. That story is irrelevant. Whether it's the Gnostic or the other Christian one, it's irrelevant. It's good versus evil. I'm the fucking best. That's just duality. That's just polarization. That's just us versus them. That's two-party political groups. That's the hockey team going after. It's just a makeup of life. We have to incorporate that. And the better and the more we understand that that's what's in us, we can use that to our advantage. That's what the hermeticist is doing. That's what the magician is doing. That's what we're doing. We're using both those poles to bring things into being. And understanding the entire time that it doesn't matter. Good or bad, it's just a point of view that could be changed and be put on either side. And sometimes two people do the exact same thing two different places in the world at the exact same time, and one's going to be considered good, one's going to be considered bad. But how can that be? It's the same act. It's like, that's how that can be. These things aren't absolute. Anyways, here we go. Listening to my man Mora.
There's a secret. Judas the Betrayer. He's been considered one of the most villainous characters of the Bible. But did you know that there's a secret gospel of Judas? Now, like Judas himself, the gospel of Judas was despised by the church. Why? Because in this heretical gospel, Jesus Christ himself reveals that everything that you know about what would become mainstream Christianity is wrong. Jesus takes Judas aside and reveals to him secrets about the creation of the world, that the 12 disciples are evil, and that God is actually the devil. Let's discover the blasphemous secrets hidden in the secret gospel of Judas. Now, before we start, I want to give a shout out. In the Gospel of Judas, there's a few things that you have to know. You see, this gospel, the Gospel of Judas, had been shrouded in mystery for almost 2,000 years. Its existence was mentioned briefly and condemned by the church father Saint Irenaeus in 180 CE in his book Against Heresies. But it was believed that no copy survived, and it was thought that this blasphemous gospel and its secrets would remain a mystery forever. But all that was about to change. Ironically, the discovery of the Gospel of Judas, like the story of Judas himself, is filled with treachery, greed, and mystery. It's believed that an Egyptian treasure hunter discovered the codex, which contains the Gospel of Judas, in Egypt in the late 1970s, and then sold it to an antiques dealer in Cairo named Hanna. But shockingly, the codex and many of his other artifacts were stolen during a robbery and taken out of Egypt. Fortunately, Hanna was able to reclaim the codex that contained the Gospel of Judas by working with another antique dealer in Geneva. So, having regained the codex, now Hanna needed to find a buyer. He was an antiques dealer, after all. A man named Stephen Emel recounts how, in 1983, a colleague of his was contacted by an antiques dealer selling ancient manuscripts. So Emil and two scholars met the dealer in a hotel room in Geneva, where they could examine the codex, but they weren't allowed to take notes or photos of any kind. So despite the codex being in a shoebox and wrapped in newspaper, at the time, it was still in pretty decent condition, all things considered. Emil knew that the codex was important, but he didn't realize that it contained the Gospel of Judas. Unfortunately, Emil couldn't afford the asking price of $3 million. In fact, most people couldn't. Hannah couldn't find any buyers, and so put the codex in a safety deposit box for 16 years. Well, guess what? A safety deposit box is not the optimal place to store an ancient text. So unfortunately, the codex sustained heavy damage. Eventually, a Switzerland antiques dealer, Frieda Neusberger Chakos, bought the codex. And so the codex is now known as Codex Chakos. Chakos allowed experts at Yale University to examine the codex, where finally the shocking discovery was made that the codex contained what was thought to be lost to time forever, the Gospel of Judas. Despite its heavy damage over the years, much of the Gospel of Judas was eventually translated, and in 2006, it was unveiled to the public by the National Geographic Society. Before we look at the blasphemous secrets of the Gospel of Judas, take a minute to reflect on its insane journey. Scholar Rodolfo Kasser said, "We can consider it a real miracle that such an ancient literary work, especially one threatened by the hatred of the great majority of its contemporary readers, who saw it as a shame and a scandal, destined to be lost, would suddenly appear and be brought to life." Not only was it brought to light, but first it was stolen, recovered, then only allowed to be viewed in secrecy, stored in a shoebox and newspaper, put up for sale for $3 million, then left to decay for 16 years in a safety deposit box. Now, according to the Gospel of Matthew, Judas betrayed Christ for 30 pieces of silver. However, the Gospel of Judas paints a much more intricate and heretical and blasphemous picture. Having survived its 1,700-year journey, what do we find within the pages of the betrayer's gospel? Is Judas even a betrayer at all? Contrary to the revealed message of the Orthodox Gospels, the opening lines of the Gospel of Judas tells us that what is about to be revealed is a secret message. The Gospel of Judas says,
"Wow, what a shitty place to stop it, eh? Fucking douchebag, ceremonial witch. Everybody was just involved in that. Everybody wanted to hear that next part. What did he say? What was so controversial? Don't worry, I'll play it for you. I hope I got everybody on the hook. So, yeah. I had something to say here. What the fuck was I going to
say? All right. Don't ask me why I added that Jesus walks. It was just funny because at the time that I was recording that, I couldn't remember what the fuck I wanted to say there after that part. And then because I took the recording off, when I took the fucking video off, it automatically went to the radio because it's on Bluetooth on my phone. And if it's inactive long enough, it just goes back to the radio. But yeah, the minute I take that off, it goes to the radio and it's playing Jesus Walks by Kanye West. And I'm talking about the Gospel of Judas, the Gnostic, I guess it'd be the Gnostic Gospels. I'm talking about those and about the truth about Christ. Okay, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying this is truthful because I don't fucking know. I don't know if this is fucking truthful or not. What I'm saying is, it was just a weird coincidence that I popped in that I wanted to play that. But there's something else I wanted to say there, right before we got into this, and I don't know, this is like over a week now, maybe even 2 weeks ago, that I made this. They're supposed to be back-to-back videos, and I totally dropped the fucking ball on that, but whatever, right? Basically, what I probably wanted to say there was probably something about, fuck, I don't even know. Don't even know. Can't even remember. I do like the fact, like I've said before, I think already previously, I do like the fact that that Judas, that he's painting the picture that there's a good chance Judas is Yalvadov. Okay? I fucking think that is sick. I think that is so cool that Judas is the incarnation of Yalvadov while he was one of Christ's apostles or disciples, okay? But it also is a weird thing, right? So, like, once again, the Gnostics, especially, this is what something Mork says a lot. I like Mork. I really do. I really enjoy his take on all the Gnostic Bible, Gospels, all the different Gnostic literature, all the texts that he has. And there is a definition of them as such. I really enjoy every single one of them. I think he's got a lot of things pretty good, pretty right, pretty accurate. I don't agree with him 100%, but I don't have to either. Once again, he wouldn't agree with me 100%, and that's fine by me as well. So it's okay to not agree with somebody, you know, and still watch their stuff and all that. Now, for some reason, like in the past, when I used to watch Thunder Wizard, I wouldn't agree with him, and it pissed me off. But with Morg, it doesn't piss me off whenever he says something that I don't agree with. It doesn't bug me as much. So maybe I'm evolving, or maybe it's just I got a clash with T-Wiz. Either way, like, I like T-Wiz, always will, and I'll always keep going back once in a while and checking on him. I'll check on his video. It's not like it matters, to be honest. But anyways, but yeah. So to me, it's kind of it's a cool concept. The Yalvadov creator, okay? Because from my perspective, the Bible was written as such that God is, and I'm not talking about Yalvadov. I'm talking about what the Christians believe. They don't know about Yalvadov. They don't think Yalvadov is an evil creator god. They don't believe none of that. That was shot out, gone, taken out of the Bible, whatever. Maybe this is just Gnostic speculation. Maybe the Gnostics found this text. All this text was written together. It's supposed to be the complete canon of the Bible. But then they took these out, and the Gnostics like, no, take the whole fucking thing. This tells us the truth. And Christians like, no, that's not true. No, that shit's true. There's no evil creator god. Blah, 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 blah. So make sure I wasn't a cop beside me on the highway and I'm talking on my phone. But once again, so we're taking texts that are after the Old Testament was written, and we're taking the texts that were, it's what Jesus said to the apostles. It's what the apostles or the disciples wrote, and they're taking Jesus's word for the creation story, okay? So all this is speculated or it's all derived from Jesus is someone who knows what the fuck is going on, okay? Because if you don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God or the Son of the real God, Sophia, because the Gnostics and Morg himself will say that he believes that Jesus is Sophia, that Jesus is Lucifer, and that's kind of a holy trinity, I guess, idea. And I know that's blasphemous. I'm not saying what I believe. And I'm not even, I don't even want to say that's what Mork believes. But I've heard him say it many times that Jesus' character is more like Sophia. And it's more, he's more like the snake in the Garden of Eden. The snake there, that was Lucifer, that's more like the real God. And Jesus is an incarnation from that. Sophia also was the Archon, was created by the Creator. But she wasn't one of the evil archons that Yalvadov is now in control of. She is above them, and she is a part of the Creator. She saw the Creator, the All, the real Creator, creating things, and she wanted to do the same thing, but she didn't know how to create the same way. She didn't put the feminine and masculine together. She didn't use the accurate ways of creating. Thus, she created Yalvadov, and he wasn't a complete creation. He wasn't done correctly, let's say. But he still had a part of, well, Sophia was part of the All, And so she had the ability to make something. Who can make stuff too? And she and Yahweh had the ability to make Adam and Ian and make Eve from Adam and all this. This is Gnostic interpretation. This is the Gnostic gospel story as I understand it, not as I believe. But once again, to me, it's just role reversal, okay? It's flipping roles around. Now, the story of Judas and Christ, it's nice. See, that's the one thing I always found strange, is Christ remains the same. He doesn't switch sides. Now, in the beginning, the role of Lucifer was being bad and Yahweh was being good, and this is the Christian interpretation would be that Yahweh, or that creator God, is the highest God, and Christ is his son. Okay, now Gnostic switches it that Yahweh is bad and more akin to Lucifer, Samael, the devil, all that, and well, maybe not the word Lucifer, because they like to think Lucifer is the bringer of light. Okay, and we have to find the light, we have to keep the light, we have to. That's why Gnostics didn't like creating children, because children are pure, and as soon as you bring them into this world, they're no longer pure, they're tainted by creation, and we have to get back to the light. So by continuing to procreate, we're doing Yahweh's bidding, as he's entrapped us here in souls, in our bodies, so that we can honor him and love him, okay? That's part of the Gnostic, just different branches of Gnosticism. That's, I think, that's part of one of the main ideas, regardless of which one you go by, but I'm not positive on that. But yeah, so every time we incarnate, make more people. We got more and more people on this earth now, but it's more souls encapsulated in bodies, and he's got more power, more people worshiping him. You know, like the Greek gods needed us to worship them in different movies and such. I don't think that's how they believed it. I really think that they believed it as these are archetypal, these are symbolic parts of us. Okay, so when you're praying to Venus, you're praying to the goddess, the empress, not the divine mother, that'd be the moon, but the beauty of art, of maybe even money. You want to get some of this stuff in your life, you give an offering to that part of you that you are not in contact with, because you're just a conscious mind, but you give that offering to that part of you that's elsewhere, but also within you at the same time, and then you can start gaining and getting what that goddess will give you, basically. And I believe that's how the Greeks thought of it too. We changed it into these things are real beings elsewhere in a different realm, and they wanted us to believe in them, and our prayers fueled them, and a lot of movies help that. It's like the same concept of the concept of God. It's like, well, we get people to believe in many gods the same way as they would believe in God, well then let's just do the same thing. It doesn't matter. But what I was trying to get at was the Gnostic speculation is all based on Jesus. Is not all of it, okay? Because a lot of these Gnostic stories are from people, and it's not always from Christ. Like the one is what Adam told Seth, his son. But, and I can't remember correctly if it's Jesus telling that story again, and it's one of the apostles that wrote that down. I can't remember all of them, but I know, like, when it comes to the one of Judas and the one of John, and there's another one, Thomas. All these ones are based on the idea that Jesus is a good character. He's either Lucifer or Sophia himself, or this is how I always thought of it, but this might be completely inaccurate, but he's still created from the all. Okay, he's someone who's all, he knows the true God, and that's what these things say, because Jesus, you'll hear him literally say, why are you giving offerings and praying to this fucking God? He's like, that's your God, that's not my God, that's not who I'm from. Anyway, it's very fascinating what happens here, okay? So, but I do want to just make it very, very known that I'm not for or against Christianity or Gnosticism. I like both ideas. I like taking all of this body of work into one and coming up with a conclusion, but at the same time always knowing that it's symbolic, it's metaphor, it's a story meant to teach, or it was just people trying to figure shit out way back when, and for us to try to interpret it now with our world as it is, with so many things that are so different from way back when they wrote that shit, is damn near impossible. But if you can still derive meaning from it, then that means there's something very important about it. Now, when there's important texts, okay? The ones that last through the ages, through time itself, okay? The ones that are always with us, the stories that always stay with us, okay? Now, once again, Christianity stayed with us a while. We can blame that on the fact that we've been indoctrinated in it and been taught it and it's been forced upon us, and fair enough, that's true. But there's things like the Greek gods I just talked about and all these different gods, and then the pantheon of fucking Norse mythology coming back in the Marvel stuff. These stories aren't going anywhere because they're important. And if we tried to dispense with them and get rid of them and tell people it's illegal to even talk about it, they would come out in another fucking way. And that means there's something about them that we need to know and understand. So that being said, the Gnostic stuff has resurfaced for whatever reason. It's gaining popularity, and it could be the fact that it's just against Christianity. There's a lot of people against it, and so anything against that is good, you know? The enemy of my enemy is my friend kind of thing, that kind of idea. It could be just that, but if it doesn't catch on to the point where people agree with it and like it, then there's something to be said about that. And if there is something there and that does happen and people do take it on, well, then great. Then we know it's something important. But that's a good, to me, that's a good way to guide or judge or go about figuring out if something is an important piece of work. Is it, if it strikes you on a fucking level that you can't even understand but you want to hear more. And that's what the Sophia story has always done for me. That's what all these Gnostics tests have always done with me. It always fucking got me somewhere where it's like, wow, there's something about this that just calls to me, you know? And it's like the Old Testament for me too. The Old Testament does that also to me more than the New Testament does. It always has. I love learning about the Old Testament, especially everything, mostly Genesis, to be honest. Most things before Jacob and Abraham normally. I don't mind the Abrahamic stories, but I find there's a lot of repetition that starts happening over and over and over again. You see the same ideas happening. It's like, I don't need to keep hearing the same fucking shit. But in the same sense, if I do stop, take the time, listen to it, I will hear things that are very important. So it just is as it is. But both the Gnostic stories and the Old Testament do something for me. Now, the reason why some of the Gnostic stories are cool is because it is from the view of the New Testament. It's the guys talking about the New Testament, but talking about the shit that happened before Christ, you know, in the Old Testament. It's the Genesis stories retold. So, and then there's even some with Moses and shit. It's crazy. So, I don't know. I guess that's kind of what I wanted to say, but I want to make it very, very fucking clear that I am not trying to dismantle anything. I'm not trying to go against Morg. I'm not trying to be for Morg. I'm not trying to teach or, I'm simply just trying to open everybody's eyes, okay? Because this good, evil paradigm that we always have, that we've always have had, that one side's good, one side's bad, that's holding us back, okay? Polarity is built into the fabric of this life, and we need it. But we don't need to create archetypal stories about beings that want to destroy us or that want to help us. We don't need that shit. We don't need to know that there's a God up there who's going to have our back, and there's a devil down there that wants to fucking fry us, and it might be the reason why we do bad acts. To me, that shit is so stupid and irrelevant that I can't believe that for evolved people like we are, we're still believing in fucking stories like that. To me, it's stupid. And so I like playing something like this that shows the reverse of what we've been told our entire life could be a potential truth. And it's just a way of showing you that regardless if God is good and Lucifer is bad, or if Lucifer was good and God, who is actually Yabadov, is bad, regardless of that shit, it doesn't matter. It's all in the perspective of you. You can look at the perspective that the snake helped us down, or the snake brought us down. You can look at the perspective that God, Yabadov, was a good guy or a bad guy, and it doesn't matter. It's all about your perspective. These stories are fascinating, but it's about your perspective. What do you think is true? And at the end of the day, does it fucking matter? Is it going to help you pay your bills? Is it going to help you do anything important? It's like, no. It might help you break some chains that are attached to your mind, though. Because if you're someone who believes in God, and then you hear these stories, and it strikes you on some level, it's like, whoa, what if God was really evil? That's what happened to me. When I started going on this journey, when I started breaking programming, it was learning about the Pope and how the Vatican did this and all these different bad things and how the elites were really satanic and Christianity was really satanic. And that fucked with my mind to the point where it opened my eyes. It got my eyes to open to the point where, oh, to the point where I was able to, okay, well, maybe there's nothing I know that is real. And then now I'm back to a place like, okay, now I'm more balanced. And but I had to be put off balance. I had to have my whole polarity switched upside down for me to stop being so ignorant and realize that, hey, maybe I don't know everything. Maybe all the answers aren't here for me and I have to go find them. Maybe I have to empty my cup so I can fucking fill it, you know? And that's what I did. And I think that's why I'm doing stuff like this. It's not to prove that the Gnostics are right. It's not to prove that Christianity is right. It's literally just try to help people flip their polarity so that if they haven't, if they think they know it all, then maybe they can start realizing that maybe they don't know it all, you know? I think that's all I'm trying to do here. So anyways, I'm going to get back to more. And I may not come back on. I may just let the story play out. But if that's the case, then thank you for everybody who subscribed. Thank you everybody who watched this, who does whatever they do, likes it and all that shit. And yeah, sorry it took so long to make this other video, but it's done now. Enjoy it. Have a great fucking day.
The Gospel of Judas says, "This is the secret message of judgment Jesus spoke with Judas Iscariot over a period of 8 days, 3 days before he celebrated Passover." The question is, why is Jesus about to reveal these secrets to Judas and not the other disciples? In the Gospel of Judas, Jesus has outright disdain for the other disciples. In a vision of priests committing shocking acts like murder and human sacrifice, Jesus tells them that those priests represent them, the disciples. He mocks their prayers and implies that they're weak, tells them that they lead the crowds astray, and ultimately reveals to Judas that the disciples don't worship God at all, but rather the devil. But why is Judas worthy of these secrets? Judas certainly isn't perfect, not by any means, as we'll certainly see at the end. But he's different. Very different. Even though Judas is very flawed, he is much more perceptive than the other disciples. And to understand this, you have to know more about why Jesus says the other disciples worship an evil God. And it all starts with a prayer. The Gospel of Judas says, "One day he was with his disciples in Judea. He found them sitting together, practicing their piety. When he came up to his disciples sitting together praying over the bread, he laughed. The disciples said to him, 'Master, why are you laughing at our prayer? What have we done? This is what's right.' He answered them and said, 'I'm not laughing at you. You're not doing this because you want to, but because through this your God will be praised.' They said, 'Master, you are the Son of our God.' Jesus said to them, 'How do you know me? Truly I say to you, no generation of the people among you will know me.' When his disciples heard this, they started to get angry and furious and started to curse him in their hearts." Now notice that Jesus refers to the being they're praying to not as God, but as your God. And this surprises the disciples, and they tell Jesus that he's the Son of their God. But Jesus then implies that they don't know who he is, and in fact, no generation among them will ever know who he is. This infuriates the disciples, going so far as to curse Jesus. Then Jesus responds, "But when Jesus noticed their ignorance, he said to them, 'Why are you letting your anger trouble you? Has your God within you and his stars become angry with your souls? If any of you is strong enough among humans to bring out the perfect humanity, stand up and face me.'" Notice that once again, Jesus referred to the God they worship as your God. This is going to be critical. None of the disciples have the courage to stand up, except for one. Judas is able to stand up and tell Jesus, "I know who you are and where you've come from. You've come from the immortal realm of Barbalo, and I'm not worthy to utter the name of the one who sent you." You see, Judas is stronger than the other disciples, and unlike the others, he knows who Jesus really is, and that he doesn't come from the God that the disciples worship. Seeing that strength and perceptiveness of Judas, Jesus says, "Come away from the others, and I'll tell you the mysteries of the kingdom." Now, Jesus is going to reveal to Judas a secret realm and the dark truth about the God that the disciples worship. Jesus reveals to Judas that the God that created Adam and Eve, which is the God the disciples worship, and the same God of what would become mainstream Christianity today, isn't the true God at all. that it's actually an immensely evil being and one of the rulers of chaos in Hades. The true God is a divine mind from which all things emanate. So Jesus is not the son of the God described in the Bible, which is an evil satanic ruler of chaos, the devil. Rather, Jesus comes from the immortal realm of the divine mind. Judas recognized this while the other disciples didn't. The Gospel of Judas isn't the only gospel to reveal the secret information. There are other secret gospels, such as the secret Gospel of John, which tells us that we are all immortal pieces of the one true God, which is a divine mind, that we are all a part of that God, that we are divine. And then the evil satanic creator God of the Bible trapped us in material bodies and tricked humanity into thinking that it was the real God. So Jesus is a messenger from the immortal realm sent to wake humanity up to the fact that they are divine and that they don't need to worship the evil creator God, but that they can tap into their own inner divinity through understanding the secret knowledge of what they truly are. That's the message according to the Gospel of Judas. Now, according to some scholars, the Gospel of Judas is a challenge to the church's authority, since many bishops would claim their authority as church leaders as coming through a direct line to Jesus' first disciples. The Gospel of Judas attempts to demolish this by saying the disciples worshiped a false evil God, that they and their generations will lead astray the faithful, engage in murder, human sacrifice, and will never know Christ. In other words, what would become Orthodox Christianity, according to the Gospel of Judas, is actually a false gospel and the opposite of truth. It's the gospel of the satanic creator God. But what about human sacrifice? Well, it's believed by some that this is a criticism of church leaders that would encourage martyrdom or dying for Christ during the persecution of the Romans. Independent scholar Mark Madison writes, "The 12 disciples are prominently featured as a group and they're consistently portrayed as unspiritual. Jesus often laughs at his disciples, mocking their practice of communion and accusing them of all kinds of misdeeds, including shocking crimes like human sacrifice and murder. For the author of Judas's gospel, church leaders who preached the value of martyrdom were guilty of human sacrifice. Since these leaders traced their authority directly to Jesus's original disciples, the author of Judas's gospel portrayed these disciples as themselves guilty of human sacrifice. Its condemnation of Jesus' disciples, then, is a thinly veiled condemnation of second century church leaders. Judas certainly is not a hero in this story, far from it. Nonetheless, he's much closer to the truth than the other disciples, and Jesus reveals the hidden truth to Judas. But the story is about to take a crazy and unbelievable twist. You see, many scholars originally thought that the Gospel of Judas portrayed Judas in a relatively positive light, that he was a hero compared to the other disciples, and that Judas was a friend to Jesus, and that his betrayal wasn't really a betrayal, that he was just following Jesus' orders. But all that was about to change, as some scholars now believe that that interpretation is all wrong. You see, upon a closer look at the gospel, something far more sinister was revealed. Jesus refers to Judas as the 13th demon when he says to Judas, "Why are you all worked up, you 13th demon?" Now, 13 references the fact that once Judas is replaced as a disciple, there will be a total of 13 disciples. But does 13 have any other kind of significance? In some Gnostic Christian literature, and the Gospel of Judas is a Gnostic text, 13 is associated with the demonic creator God, as he is sometimes known as the ruler of the 13 realms. Could Jesus be implying that Judas has something to do with the satanic creator God? Let's look at some more verses and find out. In this verse, Judas asks if his seed will dominate the rulers, Now, the rulers, or archons, are the demons that rule the material world. Master, Judas said, surely my seed doesn't dominate the rulers, does it? In response, Jesus told him, come, let me tell you about the holy generation, not so that you'll go there, but so you'll be sorry when you see the kingdom and all its generation. Jesus said, you'll become the 13th and will be cursed by other generations and will rule over them, and your star will rule over the 13th realm.
Welcome to the internet. It's a scary place with many lasers, cats, whatever that is.
Jesus is telling Judas that he won't enter the holy generation, but instead that he will become the 13th ruler. Here are some more very telling passages. Now keep in mind that the name Saklas and Yaldabaoth are both used to refer to the evil creator god. Truly I tell you, Judas, those who offer sacrifices to Saklas, everything that's evil, but you'll do more than all of them because you'll sacrifice the humanity which bears me. Your horn has already been raised, your anger has been kindled, your star has ascended, and your heart has strayed. The star that leads the way is your star. To me, it is crystal clear that Judas is no benevolent hero in this story. Based on these passages, we can come to a few possible conclusions. That Judas was secretly the satanic creator god the whole time, or that his soul will eventually become promoted to the satanic creator god, the most villainous entity in all reality. So, what is the message of the Gospel of Judas? The Gospel of Judas is a shocking criticism of what would become mainstream Christianity. Jesus reveals that the God of the Bible is not a good God, but a satanic being. Jesus shows the 12 disciples are not benevolent, but rather that they are worshipers of that satanic being, the devil. And finally, that Judas himself is to become that satanic being, the king of demons, the ruler of the 13th realm. This gospel is meant to warn the people of the world that they shouldn't be led astray by the teachings of the 12 disciples and what would become mainstream Christianity, because as long as they did, they would remain servants of the satanic creator god and never reach the truly divine immortal realm. They would never realize their own divinity. The Gospel of Judas, once thought to be lost forever, finally completed its 1700-year journey with a message to you that not everything is always what it seems, that you have the power to become divine, not by worshiping an evil god in the sky, but by looking within to realize your own divinity. So what makes more sense to you, even just as a story? Do you agree with Orthodox Christianity that the God of the Bible is loving? Or do you agree with the Gospel of Judas that it's actually an evil being? Believe it or not, this is far from the only secret book that reveals this hidden information. Check out my video on the Apocalypse of Adam, where Adam and Eve reveal that God is actually the devil. Make sure to like, share, and subscribe, and I want to give a big shout out to all my supporters on Patreon.